We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Are not afraid, and the young people taught everybody else a lesson. All the older people that had learned how to compromise and learned how to take it easy and be polite and get along and leave things as they were. The young people taught us all a lesson.
We are not afraid. We are not afraid. We are not afraid today. Oh, live in my heart. I do believe
we shall overcome someday.
We shall overcome.
The whole wide world around,
the whole wide world around, the whole wide world around, the whole wide world around.
You are listening to the We Shall Overcome in the voice of Pete Seeger. Obviously, we do wish that we shall overcome. We really do wish that we shall overcome from the pain, suffering, anxieties, disease, and death. resulting from the COVID-19 pandemic. And we do believe that we shall overcome very soon from all of these disruptions created by the novel coronavirus COVID-19 pandemic. Good afternoon, everybody. Sushagatam, everybody in this national level webinar organized by the Department of Commerce postgraduate section and undergraduate section in association with Department of Commerce, Dr. Kanailal Bhattacharyya College. I have the pleasure to welcome Sri Bajamohan Mojumdar, Honorable President, Governing Body, Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College, Dr. Kostab Lahiri, Principal, Dr. Kanailal Bhattacharyya College, Professor Prithish Kumar Roy, Honorable Member, Governing Body, Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College, Dr. Sushanto Karar, Head of the Department, Department of Commerce, Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College, Professor Chinmoy Kanti Goswami, Member, Board of Studies, Postgraduate Commerce, University of Calcutta. Our distinguished speakers, Dr. Sabat Kumar Digal, Associate Professor, Department of Commerce, Rama Devi Women's University, Bhubaneswar, Orissa. Dr. Ashish Kumar Sana, Head of the Department, Department of Commerce, and Professor of Commerce, University of Calcutta, Kolkata. My dear colleagues of Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College, my dear colleagues Dr. Kanailal Bhattacharyya College, and all the faculty members of different colleges, universities of West Bengal and other states, and also my dear students. I have the pleasure to declare that this is our second webinar in series. The first webinar was a state level webinar on COVID-19 and its impacts and precautions to be taken in educational institutions. And this is the second webinar. The topic is post-lockdown economy and the impact on micro, small, and medium enterprises, and also on education. What else could be more vibrant, more relevant topic than this? But before venturing into the main session of this national level webinar, our President, Honorable President, Governing Body, will deliver an inaugural speech and formally inaugurate this webinar. Due to some preoccupations, Honorable President could not able to join us in this webinar. However, he is good enough to send his speech through a audio clip to us, and let us hear attentively to the inaugural speech of Sri Bajamohan Mojumdar, Honorable President, Governing Body, Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College.
নমস্কার দীনবন্ধু ইনস্টিটিউশন কলেজ ও কানাইলাল ভট্টাচার্য কলেজে যৌথ উদ্যোগে আমরা যে সেমিনারের আয়োজন করেছি সকলকে স্বাগত জানাচ্ছি। এই সেমিনার আমাদের তরফ থেকে দ্বিতীয় পর্যায়ের সেমিনার। প্রথম পর্যায়ে কোভিড-19 করাল আক্রমণ প্রতিহত করার, তার থেকে মুক্তি পাবার কিছু উপায় নির্ধারণ করেছিলাম আমরা একটি সেমিনারে, এবং সেই সেমিনারে অনুবৃত্তি ধরেই আজকে এই সেমিনার। এই সেমিনারের মুখ্য বিষয়বস্তু করোনার কালো ছায় বিধ্বস্ত ধরা গ্রামে, তত ভারতবর্ষে, তত এই রাজ্যে চারিদিকে যে ধ্বংসের লীলা আমরা প্রত্যক্ষ করছি, শিক্ষার ক্ষয়, ব্যবসা বাণিজ্যের ক্ষয়, আর্থিক মন্দা, চারিদিকে হাহাকার, সেই জায়গায় দাঁড়িয়ে আমরা জীবনের যে বাঁচিয়ে রাখার তাগিদ নিয়ে এখনো যুদ্ধ করে চলেছি। ইতিমধ্যে অন্য দ্বারও আমরা উন্মুক্ত করেছি। আমরা দেখতে চাইছি যে সেই জায়গায় দাঁড়িয়ে কিভাবে এই ক্ষুদ্র কুটির শিল্প, যা মানুষের ঘরে ঘরে জীবিকার সংস্থান করে, মানুষের আত্মবিশ্বাসকে ভরপুর করে তোলে, মানুষের জীবনী শক্তিকে বাড়িয়ে দেয়, সেই ধারণাকে পুষ্ট করার জন্যে কিভাবে আমরা সেই ছোট্ট ছোট্ট শিল্প, ক্ষুদ্র শিল্পকে আবার পুনরুদ্ধার করতে পারি। আমরা আলোচনা করব এই সেমিনারে যে শিক্ষা ব্যবস্থায় প্রায় অর্গল বদ্ধ হয়ে আছে, শিক্ষার লয়ের দ্বার এখনো উন্মুক্ত হয়নি সবার কাছে, সেখানে দাঁড়িয়ে এই ভার্চুয়াল সেমিনারের মাধ্যমে এবং নানা ধরনের চৈতন্য সঞ্চারী মাধ্যমের মধ্য দিয়ে আমরা কি করে ছাত্র সমাজকে এবং শিক্ষা জগৎকে আবার জীবনমুখী, জীবিকামুখী করতে পারি, তারই দিশা নির্দেশ করবে এই সেমিনার। এই সেমিনারে অনেক মানুষ, বিখ্যাত প্রতিথযশ অধ্যাপক, তারা বক্তব্য রাখবেন। বক্তব্যদের বক্তাদের তালিকায় আমরা আগেই বলেছি যে আমাদের ডক্টর কানাইলাল ভট্টাচার্য কলেজের অধ্যক্ষ ডক্টর কৌস্তব লাহিড়ি এবং দীনবন্ধু ইনস্টিটিউশন কলেজ তার অধ্যক্ষ ডক্টর মণিদীপ চন্দ্র, তাদের যৌথ উদ্যোগে এই সেমিনার আহূত হয়েছে। তারাও বক্তব্য রাখবেন। বক্তব্য রাখবেন বিশিষ্ট অধ্যাপক নেতা এবং কথিত যশা অধ্যাপক পৃথ্বী রায়, এবং প্রধান বক্তা হিসাবে উপস্থিত থাকবেন কলকাতা বিশ্ববিদ্যালয়ের বাণিজ্য বিভাগের প্রধান ডক্টর আশিস কুমার সাদা। সঙ্গে আরো অনেকেই বক্তা হিসেবে থাকবেন, থাকবেন অধ্যাপক সনদ শবত কুমার বিগাল, তিনি আছেন, তিনিও বক্তব্য রাখবেন। রাখবেন অধ্যাপক সুশান্ত খাড়া, অধ্যাপক চিন্ময় কান্তি গোস্বামী, তাদের বক্তব্যে আমরা সমৃদ্ধ হব। মূল কথা এটাই, যারা আমরা শুনব, যারা আমরা অংশগ্রহণ করব, যারা আমরা প্রতিজ্ঞাবদ্ধ হয়েছি যে এই করাল ছায়া দিকে, কালো ছায়া দিকে আমরা আবার পৃথিবীর সঙ্গে সঙ্গে নতুন আলো বাতাস প্রত্যক্ষ করব, তারা যেন আজকে আমরা এই সেমিনারে দীক্ষা নিতে পারি। যে মন্ত্র আমরা শিখব এই সেমিনারের মধ্য দিয়ে, সেই মন্ত্র আমরা জীবনভর শিক্ষালয়ের বাইরে ভিতরে আমরা সাধন করে তুলব, এবং তারই মাধ্যমে প্রথম জীবন সঞ্চার করব। শুধুমাত্র ক্ষুদ্র কুটির শিল্পের নয়, শুধুমাত্র শিক্ষালয়ের নয়, সমগ্র জাতির জীবনে নতুন চৈতন্যের অনুরণন আমরা ঘটাবো। এইটুকুনি আমাদের আজকের এই প্রারম্ভিকার বক্তব্য, এবং আমরা আশা করি সবাই সমৃদ্ধ হবেন, সবাই শুনবেন, এবং এইটুকুন বলেই আমি আমার প্রস্তাবনার কালকে শেষ করলাম, এবং এই সেমিনারে শুভ উদ্বোধনের মুহূর্তকেও আপনাদের সামনে স্পষ্ট করে দিলাম। নমস্কার।
Let me give you a very short introduction to the theme, today's topic, that is the post-lockdown economy and its impact on MSME and education. It goes without saying that the present slowdown of the economy is the direct impact of the lockdown of the country. And the impact is quite visible, has been visible for the last few months through the various economic contractions and the posting of sluggish figures. As a matter of fact, by default, MSME sector is the worst hit, one of the worst hit sectors in India. As a matter of fact, they are facing severe solvency risk and as well as liquidity risk, because 25% of the MSME loan could slip into default compared to 6% only in the corporate sector. Experts are making plans, especially after the initiation of the unlockdown program. Experts are making plans to restore the economy, taking into consideration of the new normals, the new realities. However, the opening up of sectors selectively was not found very feasible, simply because the different sectors are tightly intertwined. For example, an export, a garment export factory may require chemicals for processing, may require paper and plastics for packaging, may require spare parts for its sewing machines, may require consumable goods like threads for the stitching. So it's a very complex situation, it's a very unique situation, it's a novel situation created by novel coronavirus. So let us have a quick glance to sum up to all the things that are happening. Let us have a quick glance to the following slides. Now we are seeing that this is the impact on MSME, that is the destruction caused by the COVID-19, that is the disruption caused by the COVID-19. And the various experts from various fields are trying relentlessly to make it a reality, to restore the economy. And then we find that the different sectors of the economy has been affected by a different scale and different factors. As a matter of fact, the airlines and hotels, auto and advanced industries, construction and real estate, textile, and also freight and logistics are greatly affected, severely affected by the COVID-19 situation. In contrast with that, the telecommunications, the pharmaceuticals, the IT service, and agriculture, and of course, to some extent, the chemicals, these sectors are least affected. So we have to take into consideration these particular figures while discussing the impact of post-lockdown economy on the MSME and also education. So there is the sinking feeling. That is the 69 million number of MSMEs, approximately. Main challenges for MSMEs: cash crunch due to the slowdown of business, and delays in movement of perishables may cause losses. Low or zero manpower as daily wages flee to their hometowns. And there is some new figures, that is 120 million number of people are employed in MSMEs, not a matter of joke, and 22.8 lakh crore total outstanding credit to MSME. And there is a collateral demand for loans, 45 lakh crore. And the MSMEs have been redefined, re-engineered and reconceptualized. And and definitions have been changed. Previously, it was up to 25 lakh investment called micro, but now it is up to 5 crore. Previously, it was over 25 lakh, but below or up to 5 crore as the small. But now the small enterprises will be defined as over 5 crores and up to 75 crores. And similarly, the medium enterprise has also been raised from 75 crores to 250 crores. So this is another background that is also should be the point to be noted. And now go on to the impact on education. Traditionally, the education to some extent viewed by the general public like this, that is on the left hand side, the teacher, the middle student, the burden is on the student, entire burden is on the student, and on the right side, there is the university that collecting money. Now, this was the situation of the classroom before the COVID-19 situation. So the classroom full of pupils and full of vibrant. But now this is the classroom after the COVID-19 situation. It has also an economic impact because the universities and colleges are sinking of money, sinking of income in terms of tuition fees and others. Now, there has been an ex-concurrent, ex-post lockdown education in Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College, a case study that I am presenting before you, that you may recall that from 16 March onward, all the education institutions throughout West Bengal have been shut down. And shutting down, after the shutting down, we cannot stop. Education institution can be shut down, but education cannot stop. So we acted quickly, acted in a right manner, and from the very first day, that is from the 16 March 2020, we started online classes. And from the graph you are viewing that 55 teachers has joined in the very first week, just after the shutting down of the education institutions. And the 15 teachers joined in the second week, 7 teachers in the third week, and the 4 teacher in the fourth week. And the teachers are using various modes of online education. There are Google Classroom, there are WhatsApp group, there are Zoom meeting app, there are Skype, there are Discord, there are emails, ordinary emails, and so on, so forth, and whatnot. And ultimately, the Google Classroom become very popular, and 85 Google Classroom has been created by teachers spread over 17 departments of Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College. There are Zoology Department, Urdu Department, Statistics Department, Sanskrit Department, Political Science, Physics, Philosophy, Mathematics, History, Geography, English, Education, Economics, Commerce, Chemistry, Botany, etc. Now, so far as the online and learning teaching is concerned, it has been attended by 1,200 students of Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College out of approximately 3,200 students. But the 2,000 students who has been left out of this online education is not due to the fact that they cannot afford internet, is not due to the fact that they cannot afford Android phones. Simply, we fail to reach them because we do not have any connection like email ID or WhatsApp number, etc. We have tried to collect those email IDs, but they found to be not correct. So far as we have made a survey, perception survey, students perception survey, and so far as 966 replies has been received from the students. Now let us see the replies. The first question is, are you attending online classes for the first time? 90.3% responded yes. That is only 9.7% have a prior knowledge of online classes. The second question was, what do you mean by online classes? The majority of the pupils, majority of the students, that is 58.3%, responded online classes means online learning. And a good number of students indicated that online classes means having live interactions with the teachers. Next question was asked, what device do you use for online classes? 960 students replied they use smartphone. Only 30 students replied they use laptops. 9 students use desktop PC. 1 student tablet. And 6 others use others, means cyber cafe and the like. Next question is, how long have you been using smartphone, laptop, computer? 50% answered that they are using it for 1 to 5 years. And 38% are less than 1 year. Next question is, how much expert are you in using smartphones, computers during online classes? 43.4% replied good. 24.8% replied very good. And 15.8% replied they are excellently expert in using smartphones, etc. Next question, how much expert are you while attaching, uploading files to email? 64.5% replied they can easily attach. 25.6% replied they can very easily attach. And only 9.9% replied they cannot attach or upload files to emails. Next question was, how much expert are you while downloading files from internet? 60.6% replied that they are easily, and 36.1% very easily. Do you possess any degree, diploma, certificate in computer course? So 59.2% replied that no. Remember, 59.2% replied no, but still if you review the earlier question, but they are quite excellent in transmitting, attaching, and taking online classes. 28.6% replied certificate. They have certificate in computer course. And whenever they are asked about the different modes of online classes they have attended, 616 students replied they attended WhatsApp, and 694 students replied they attended Google Classroom. So Google Classroom is very much popular. And there are other Zoom meeting apps, Skype, Team Link meeting app, YouTube Link, Google Duo, Discord, Facebook. Even Facebook also being used by students and teachers, and email is there also. And how well the teaching style of the online courses match your learning style? And extremely well response is 24.8%, and quite well is 25.4%, and fairly well is 22.6%. So overall, students are satisfied. Students are satisfied. And next, how would you rate the online classes based on overall satisfaction? So excellent is only 9.9%, and good is 43.5%. And the percentage of syllabus covered till then. So percentage syllabus covered, 55 to 69% syllabus has been covered, responded by 33.1%. Even 85 to 100% syllabus has been completed, replied by 11.5%. And what do you like to prefer when they ask question, 100% online classes or 100% classroom classes, or in between, a blending of online classes and the classroom classes? So 36.4% replied 50% online classes and 50% classroom classes. And 100% online classes responded 12.9%. And 100% classroom classes responded 15.4%. So overall, there is a tendency among the students to have a blending, have a mixture of online and offline classes. And that is the only way in the COVID-19 situation. And there is no immediate chance of being a situation of a zero level COVID situation. So these are the perception survey, and and so far as I have tried to introduce the theme before the audience, before the viewers, and now we will introduce our dignitaries on the stage, the virtual stage. And first I introduce Professor Prithish Kumar Roy, Honorable Member, Governing Body, Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College. Next I introduce Dr. Sushant Kanar, Head of the Department of Commerce, Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College. Next I introduce Professor Chinmoy Kanti Goswami, Member, Board of Studies, PG Commerce, University of Calcutta. Next I introduce our distinguished speakers. First, Dr. Shabath Kumar Digal, he's the Associate Professor, Department of Commerce, Ramadevi Women's University, Bhubaneswar, Orissa. And in fact, Dr. Shabath Kumar Digal began his career in teaching with the degree college in Purulia, West Bengal. Therefore, he joined his own alma mater, the Postgraduate Department of Commerce, Utkal University, Bhubaneswar, India, on 25th June 2004, and continued till 26th July 2018. And Dr. Shabath's doctoral degree research was on the competencies of women entrepreneurs of tribal and non-tribal districts of Orissa. As on that, Dr. Shabath has published 45 articles in various national, international journals, published 3 books, and presented research papers in about 60 national and international seminars and conferences. He successfully guided 3 doctoral scholars and 17 MPhil scholars. Now, we'd like to introduce my personal friend and very renowned teacher, Dr. Ashish Kumar Sana, Head of the Department and Professor, Department of Commerce, University of Calcutta, Kolkata. And he was the Director of University of Calcutta, Calcutta Stock Exchange Center for Excellence in Financial Market. During the period 2015 to 2017, he was the Program Officer, National Service Scheme, University of Calcutta, 2008 to 2017, and member of the advisory committee. And he has research interest in financial markets and institutions, mutual funds, microfinance, small business, women entrepreneurship and development. And number of researchers has done research work, PhD work, MPhil work under him. Till that, 12 MPhil students and 6 PhD students have got their degrees under the able guidance of Dr. Ashish Kumar Sana. He has completed the Global Financial Crisis project under the UPE scheme of encouragement to young faculty other than science and technology. A numerous publications has been published in different journals. So far as 30 different journals, and he have got published on his own credit 10 different books, and numerous book chapters has in own credit. So this is the end of the introduction of our speaker. Now I will request our Honorable Member of the Governing Body, Professor Prithish Kumar Roy, to say a few words about this national level webinar. Dr. Prithish Kumar Roy, please.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is indeed a great pleasure to be invited in such a seminar organized by Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College and Dr. Kanailal Bhattacharyya College, Howrah. this seminar is a fallout, direct fallout of the unprecedented and unbelievable shutdown. Every sphere of human life has come to a grinding halt nowadays. It's a traumatic phase. The economy has been shattered, and so are industries. Naturally, every walk of life has come to a grinding halt. The world had gone through numerous economic disasters in the recorded history. The economic depression of 1929 and global meltdown of 2008 are the recent memories. Both the event had tremendous ill effect in our economy, in our national economy, as well as the global economy. But this global lockdown has decimated everything. This is unprecedented, and the scale, the sheer scale and the magnitude of this a lockdown cannot be measured in any conventional parameters. So this is unprecedented. Entire globe is now passing through massive retrenchment and shrinkage of economy. Global economy, global GDP is now one of the lowest in the recorded history. The Indian economy was very weak even before, just before the lockdown. But lockdown has given the last nail in its beak. It has come to the negative territory even. From 10% economic growth to a negative economic growth. This sea change will shatter the fabric, the social, cultural, and economic fabric of our society. The weak economy has been further weakened, and MSME is no exception. MSME, we may consider it as the growth engine, particularly the country's emerging economies like China and India were all banking on the MSMEs. But the impact of this lockdown will be much bigger in this MSME, and that will destroy the workforce, and that will be elaborately discussed in the seminar, I hope. I welcome the professor, associate professor of Ramadevi College and University, Bhubaneswar, Mr. Samut, Professor Samut, and our own Professor Ashish Kumar Sana, head of the department, Calcutta University. I welcome them in this seminar, I hope the entire seminar will be one of the best of its kind, and we will enjoy it in the next 1 hour and 30 minutes. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
sorry, due to technical difficulties, we are for some we have gone out of track. Now we have restored the thing. Now we have restored the thing. Now I request. I request Dr. Sushant to deliver his brief lecture about this national level webinar. Dr. Karnar, do you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, carry on.
Okay, sir. Good afternoon to the Honorable President, respected Speaker, respected Principal Sir, delegates, participants, and all others. I again welcome all of you in today's webinar. Today is really a memorable day for the Department of Commerce, Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College, Howrah. Our department started its journey in the year of 1960 by introducing BCom Honours courses and gradually BCom Pass courses in the year of 1977. In every year, a number of students graduated from this department with first class, and in number of years, our students secured first class first in the university's examination. Shibpur Dinobundhoo Institution College is widely known as one of the best commerce college in the Howrah district. Our present principal, Sir Dr. Monirud Chandu, is a highly encouraging and motivating person. He always encouraging us to do something for the department, for the college. Today's webinar is the result of his encouragement. Today's webinar topic is post-lockdown economy, impact on MSME and education. I think it is the right time to discuss about this topic. MSME and education both are highly relevant area. More or less, we know the importance of the MSME sector to Indian economy. Just I am giving few points relating to such to informing all why we are choosing that topic. MSME sector is second largest employment job creator sector after the agriculture. Its last 5 years average contribution towards the GDP is 29.73%. Its average growth rate is 10.95%. Its share towards the export around 49.69% of the total export value. More than 11.10 crores people are engaged in this sector. It acts as a complementary to large industries as ancillary units, and this sector contributes significantly in the industrial development. MSME play crucial role in providing large employment opportunities at comparably lower capital cost comparing to large industries. More than 6,000 different types of products and services are provided by this sector. This sector is considered as highly vibrant and dynamic sector in Indian economy. I am not going to discuss in details relating to the what are the actual impact of the COVID-19 on this sector and education sector, as that too part to be discussed by our expert. Thanks to all of you.
Thank you, Dr. Karan. Now I will request Professor Simon Kanti Goswami to deliver a brief lecture about this national level webinar. Professor Chinmoy Kanti Goswami.
Hello. Good afternoon to our respected president of our college, and good afternoon to our respected principal. And my heartiest congratulations to the honorable guests and speakers who have come forward for making this webinar a success. Now, the time is very limited. We are running very short of time. So now I am going to discuss two or three points. What is the impact of lockdown and what is the impact of COVID-19 crisis on educational institution? Actually, due to lockdown, we are getting panic every day, and we are very much shocked. Every sphere of life are very much shocked due to this pandemic situation. Actually, so many educational institutions, whatever may be the nature, this primary school, college, and university, and other institution, private and government, are closed down. Total education system of the globe has been negatively affected by this pandemic situation. We don't know what the normal situation will prevail again. Now we are at a fix to determine our future policy, because education and human resource development are the actually foundation of the national economic development. Now, according to UNICEF report, approximately 98.5% of the world's student population have been affected by this pandemic situation all over the world. And also our country is severely affected by this pandemic situation due to crisis created by COVID-19. This lockdown situation actually created a major shock in every sphere of life. We actually learned many things. We accepted many bad habits as good habits. And we actually have to discard many bad habits due to this pandemic situation. Our country actually is severely affected because our economy is not going well before lockdown, but after lockdown, our economy also is badly affected. Educational institution also is badly affected due to this lockdown. The students, learners, and teachers also are getting panic every day because of this situation. How can we remove from this pandemic situation? Only God knows. We cannot say what will be our destiny. Actually, the authorities and government, state government and central government, is thinking and rethinking their policy on the basis of the real situation. In near future, what will happen, we don't know. According to the estimate, the private institutions are actually badly affected. The teachers actually who are working in the private organization, their salary is cut. Some a few days ago, I got one figure that, one estimate that some private teachers, private institution teachers actually have been removed from the institution due to the situation. And they have been told that again, when normal situation will prevail, they will come forward to enter the institution. Actually, the higher education is also affected because the higher education is the cornerstone of our economic development. The final year students who are the end product of our institution, they will be affected from the demand side, also from the supply side. They cannot get job opportunities after passing the examination because total education cycle, total exam cycle are badly affected, and total education cycle and exam cycle are lingered. And the authorities are thinking to take the examination online, but there are some limitations of online taking online examination and online study. Actually, the disadvantaged people are severely affected due to this lockdown. The students who are coming from the poor families, they are badly affected because they their families cannot run their family well due to lockdown. They cannot earn sufficiently as they earned before lockdown. And in this lockdown situation, some students, it has been reported that some students actually were compelled to adopt the means of selling vegetables and pulling rickshaws, etc. Today, I got one news from by reading the newspaper. Now, one student, he actually couldn't buy Android phone, and his family actually couldn't afford Android phone for online study. Therefore, I am very much shocked by observing this type of situation. The teachers or the learners who are in the government organization, they are little better than the private organization. The private organization cannot afford the teachers sufficiently, and the students also are badly affected. So now the government and the authorities are thinking and rethinking their scheme by sitting from time to time what will be the policy. But the real situation actually will say in future where will go, what will be our destiny. So good afternoon to all. Time is very short, and I convey my heartiest thanks to all the participants, guest speakers, and the organizing committee of this webinar of our college. Welcome to all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Goswami. Now we will invite our distinguished speakers. First, I will invite our distinguished speaker, Dr. Sabot Kumar Digal. Dr. Digal, please. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for inviting me. Just let me share the screen and then I'll go ahead with that. So, respected principal of Shibpur Dinobundhoo College, Dr. Monideep Chandra, respected principal Dr. Kostov Lahari of Dr. Kanailal Bhattacharyya College, in absentia, President Sri Brajaman Majumdar, Professor Pritish Kumar Roy, Professor Chinma Gandhi Goswami, my good friend and another speaker for today, Professor Ashish Kumar Sana, who is the head of the Department of Commerce and University of Calcutta, Dr. Sushant, the head of the department of the college, other organizers, participants, and ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I really thank all of you for having invited me to this seminar. And in the inaugural speech, both our principal and other speakers have spoken a lot about MSMEs and also education. And by speaking that, actually, you have made my job much easier. I'll take your speech, inaugural speech, as a base, and then quickly switch over to where I want to go. So what I do is that I have, just to structure my presentation, I have named it as Evolving Trends in Education During Febrile Socioeconomic Conditions, some thoughts. I repeat, I have kept it as Evolving Trends in Education During Febrile Socioeconomic Conditions, some thoughts. So why I have done that is what, and here you find my outlines. MSME economy, I will not touch on that. My other speaker, Professor Sana, will speak on that. But I'll just touch upon one, two lines just to set a context. And then who are the winners of the pandemic? This has again been discussed. I won't touch. Just have a passing reference. Then current scenario in education and the skills, comparison, pre and post, way forward, and concluding remarks. Before I get into this, I would like to say one thing here, that whatever I'm going to present today, those are the culmination of my experience, personal experience, general impression prevailing in the society, and bit of my research. Like the principal of the college was showing about the research. I too had done some research, but those research findings I'm not showing here because of paucity of time. I'll only make a passing reference to that. So, and here it is not to attack anybody, not to downgrade anybody. This is just to put across what is the general impression doing the rounds and what you are supposed to be doing. But again, it's possible that not it's possible, it's true that most of us are actually working very hard to see that our object, our students actually become the beautiful final products. But somewhere something is going wrong, and because of which, if you look at the entire financial stimulus, education was not mentioned. And even then, all those steps have been taken for all the sectors, but education is the sector which has yet to receive any attention. It has not received any attention. So taking these into consideration, I am going to present. So this has already been discussed. Only the first line, you can see the MSME is the backbone of the country, backbone of the economy of the country. And when you see the photographs or the video clips of migrant laborers walking back from their place of work to place of residence or place of native place, and you have seen the photographs that some children are being dragged on the vehicles, they are being dragged on the luggage, some dying on the way, some are not getting food, people are coming like cattle in one vehicle, crammed into one vehicle, all those you see. But when they come back, now problem with the government is what? That once they have returned from the place of work, they have to come back, they have come back to their native place. You cannot allow them to die or remain hungry. You have to provide them employment. And if you have to provide them employment, only solution is your MSME, that is micro, small and medium enterprises. So having said it, I just say that everybody has said in the beginning, who has actually been the winner and who has lost. We know all the big ticket investors, say airlines, tourism, services, they have all been battered, and even automobiles been battered. But there are a few silver lines during this pandemic. Those who were catering to the small scale businesses, or those who are catering to the small requirements, for example, a biscuit company or biscuit manufacturing company, or even small medicines, not all the medicines, those who are catering to the big medicines, but those who are catering to small medicines, they have actually all been successful. Here you can see last but one, Amazon. But Amazon is a big company, but I'm not talking about Amazon's revenue as a big company. I'm talking about Amazon's revenue that has really risen because of home delivery of small products. What I'm trying to say here is that no matter you are a big company or a small company, the focus has always been on the small ones. And some winners were what? The last time, as you see, that companies with good rural reach, they have actually become successful. But apart from all that, I said that we have migrants returning back, we have MSMEs doing good, but again, we have those who are having a rural reach, they're doing good. But amongst MSMEs, there are some problems. Professor Asisana will cover on that. There are some problems. That problem is known as missing middle. What is the missing middle? You can see that this word was coined by Kruger in 2013. What he said, that about 93% of enterprises are in micro level. MSME is micro, small and medium enterprises. So those are in micro levels. But to provide employment to all those who have just returned or are still returning back from big cities to their villages, we need to convert or upgrade these micro enterprises into smaller and medium enterprises. But this upgradation from micro to smaller and medium is not taking place. And the last line you can see here, that innovation. Innovation is something which our MSMEs are not doing. So if we depend so much on MSMEs, we have so much of employment here, which we have already talked about. And then finally, we have this missing middle and innovation is a problem. Then where do we stand? What should be our education? That is what I'm going to discuss today on this. Now, when I discuss about education, let's see that what were the pre-pandemic employment challenges. See, through employment, when we talk about employment, we talk about education. Without education, one cannot have employment. Of course, in education, we again say that one is educated, but one is skilled enough. So I mix both education and skills together, though those are very separate things, assuming that we teachers are imparting skills also. So just see what has happened before pre-pandemic thing. That what was the job scenario? The 80% of the jobs were coming from non-traditional sectors. Then the largest car owner, I say that these are the conditions before pre-pandemic. The largest car owner, who was Ola and Uber, did not have a single car for a business purpose, but they were the largest car owners in the world. the largest social networking platform provider without owning a single telecom company. Similarly, largest seller of the products, Amazon and Flipkart, they never manufactured a single product. See that we already had a scenario where it wanted a different look. It was a pre-pandemic scenario. What I'm trying to say here is that already we had got signals that something big is going to happen. I'm not talking about the disease. I'm talking about something sea change. A big change is in the offing. It is coming. Were you really prepared for that? Were you really preparing our students, keeping this into consideration is what? And on top of that, when you talk about all these webinars and all, that last time you can see that technology is getting outdated every 2 hours. So when technology is getting outdated every 2 hours, what is the case? Have you really been prepared? And on top of that, you see here that McKinsey and Transparency International report, it says that only quarters of the graduates are employable and they're not skilled enough to take advantage or to adapt to the changing situations. And why these problems? These problems are, or this inability to take advantage or to get adapted to changing situations is because of the prevailing education system. I repeat, is because of prevailing education system. I'm not saying this. This is the finding of a study. So whenever we say that our children, means our students, because no matter how big is a student, we'll always remain as children to us. If our children or the students are not skilled to take advantage and they are not able to adapt themselves to the changing situations, and that failure is coming because of education system, and we are the medium through which education is or knowledge is being imparted, then who is to be blamed here? I had told in the beginning, I'm not here to blame anybody, but I'm just saying that blame or the fingers, accusing fingers are actually pointing at us. I'm also a teacher. So what I'm saying that if we had already known that there are changes which are coming, which are knocking, and we have actually not taken steps, then what will happen? And even some those who have taken steps to skill them, it is like that Sir Ken Robinson says that we are preparing for the future, means we are preparing our students by doing what we did in the past. See, it's a wonderful thing that we are preparing our students for the future, but we are preparing them keeping our past methods into consideration. So if you do that, then what happens? Can you really win the war against poverty? I repeat, can you really win the war against poverty? And can you really prepare or create the human capital? When I say war against the poverty, there are scopes, MSME is there, but MSME itself cannot provide us employment. Someone has to take charge of that. And who will take charge tomorrow? That is the human resource we create, or the human capital we create, that is our students. But if we had already heard about, you had sensed about the problems or the changes, but we have not prepared them for the future, if you are preparing them with the old methods, then how to win the war against this poverty? That means we'll have more of those migrant laborers returning back, or we'll have more of those migrant or the unemployment cases. And if not today, tomorrow we are going to be blamed for this. Now, let's see that what are the 21st century skills. The left side, you find what are the intended skills, means what we're supposed to impart to them, but what skills we have actually focused. Again, I say here, there are some wonderful teachers, excellent teachers, those who are keeping track or keeping pace with the changing environment. I'm generalizing it. And because I'm generalizing, so it's there. And I also recall here that our principal has already said he had made a study that online study and the students are enjoying. I'll come to that part. When students say they're enjoying online classes, why? I'll come to that. So now what are the intended skills? I won't explain this, time is not there. So intended was, today we wanted adaptive skills, that adaptation to the life, that changing facets in life has to be adapted. And then socio-cultural global citizenship. That means that a student has to behave like a global citizen, not a citizen of a particular country. Then the third one, most of us, those who are listening are commerce teachers, they'll be knowing this productivity. Today, we are not bothered about how much we produce. We are bothered about how much maximum you produce with how much minimum of cost. I repeat, we are bothered with, or you are concerned with, how much maximum we can produce with how much minimum cost. Now I am saying, have you really prepared our students to have maximum output with minimum cost? When sir was saying that there are difficulties, I'll also show those, then probably we have not trained them properly. Now I'll come to the right side. You can look at the skills and focus in the right side. That we should have focused side, but we have focused on right side. What is that? We have tried to focus on content. When you look at UGC or anybody, we are trying to change the content. I'm not saying content changes. Now you need to change the content, but content has to be learning. Content has to facilitate learning. But content is what we are changing it. But many a times what happens, as per the content, that is actually not giving us jobs, or that is not skilled enough. And curriculum also, same way it is going on. If some there are some questions, I'll discuss on that. I'm not elaborating on this. Then outcomes. Yes, we have outcomes. There are some training programs on outcome-based studies. We are also focusing on outcomes, but those outcomes are not on the skills. Those outcomes are on the grades. Again, I repeat, if some of you are getting angry by this time, that what I'm trying to say here is that there are some teachers who are exceptional, but most of us probably were not doing this, and because of which that unemployment or all those problems are there. So this is what we have been focusing. So when there is a gap between intended skills and skills on focus, then what happens? You look at here, this is not the current figure, this is an old figure, but it's still relevant today, that you look at the skill status. That why this skill comes? Because of this one, that what skills we should have imparted to our students and what skills we have really focused, and because of which, where do you stand today? If you look at the developed nations, about Germany, Japan, South Korea, see what is the percentage of their students or youth being skilled. If you look at India, about only 4% are skilled. And who is to be blamed? Again, I'm not talking about the government, I'm not talking about the institutions. What I'm saying, students spend maximum time with us of their lifetime. So are you not here, or can you not part with that? Can you not share that blame? Now, another problem is what? That we are preparing our students for the present, or we are actually preparing for the future. I just mentioned in the last but one slide that we are focusing more on the content. We are focusing more on the, if you look at, just in case you miss it, you look at the right side, first one, we are focusing more on the content and we are focusing on the curriculum. And that was a skill. So when you're focusing more on the content and the curriculum, what happens? We prepare our students for the present. But problem is what? When they are actually ready, means they are passed out, they are passing graduation or BCom or BA or even MCom or MA or MSc, and the moment they go to the job, they are not fit there. Why? Because job requirement has changed. I repeat, we are very dedicated, very sincere. We are sincerely preparing our students for the present. But now education doesn't demand that we prepare our students for the present. It demands that we prepare our students for the future. But my question is, how can we prepare our students for the future unless and until we have peeked into the future, unless and until we have sense of the future? Only because we are preparing our students for the present, so there is maximum unemployment rate or maximum disgruntledness and maximum problems. So then if our present, even there are some who are also preparing for the future, what is happening that actually we are preparing them or we are preparing the future. There is a difference. Like, Franklin Roosevelt had said, we cannot always build the future for our youth, but we can build our youth for the future. I repeat, we cannot always build the future for our youth, but we can build our youth for the future. Why this makes sense here is that even if we are thinking we are preparing them for the future, actually we are trying to make the future secured. Please, if you are trying to make the future secure for our students, then we are failing. Rather, what we need to do is that we need to build our youth for the future. Means what? If they are skilled, if they have learned all those skills, they know how to face the life, how to face the society, then actually they are prepared. You have seen that there are so many cases of suicides during pandemic. Some are reported, some are not reported. But why it's happening? Because they were all in the present. They were not in the future. But we as the frontline warriors of the future, I repeat, we as the frontline warriors of the future, we cannot prepare our students for the present. We have to prepare our students for the future. But in the process of preparing our students for the future, sometimes we are trying to secure the future for them. Please let us not commit this mistake of trying to secure the future for the students or the youth. Rather, let us build our youth or the students for the future. Once we do that, then the huge gap which exists between our initiatives and tangible outcomes, that will be bridged. If you remember, if you recall, I was just saying that we are very sincere, we are very hardworking. This just give a thought to itself that we are working hard, but is our hard work commensurate to the output? If it is not, there is something to give serious thought to that. So now I had discussed about pre-pandemic. This was the case in pre-pandemic. With all those, we had a huge gap between initiatives and tangible outcomes. Now look at what the post-pandemic, what skills exactly are required. These are whatever I'm citing, these are all the findings of research. So this post-pandemic skills are what? Creativity. Creativity is not about thinking very complex. It's about trying something very simple solutions. Like you just see, whenever somebody asks something, say, let's say one driver you want. But again, if you go to the pre-pandemic one, driving job was at risk because we have driverless cars. Again, have you really prepared? I'm not saying we are preparing our students to become drivers. But I'm saying if we're not preparing our students to become drivers, are we really preparing them to prepare the software of a driverless car? Again, please don't get into the debate. I'm not a science teacher. I'm a commerce teacher. It's not about science and commerce. I'm saying adaptability. So are we really making them creative? Are they coming out with simple solutions to the big problems? Do they really know that your big problems can be divided into simple solutions or big aim of life can be achieved by achieving small targets? Are you really preparing them with that? If you are not preparing something, it's a high time we have to do that. Then communication, all of us know we are teachers, best communicators, but look at the WhatsApp messages every day we get. In WhatsApp messages, only we read those messages which are crisp and lucid. If those are small messages and very clear messages, we read and we understand. But if those are long messages, we don't have time to read. And those messages mostly are not for us, but for the students. And if those are for students, now you see that what kind of communication we have with our students in the class or outside, and what kind of communication skills we are imparting to our students also. That is something to be seen. Then collaboration is required. I'm not talking about the collaboration that we have, say, we have a collaboration now. I am in Odisha, you are in West Bengal, in different parts of the country. We have collaborated, we have joined together. But thing is, out of this collaboration, what is a critical thinking emerging? What critical thinking? Today I was very happy when you started with We Shall Overcome. I have attended so many webinars. But we used to start seminars in a normal way. But I was very touched today that when they sang this one, that We Shall Overcome. This is a song when I was in NSS, National Service Scheme, as a student. This used to be our anthem. But today, it not only made me nostalgic, this has told me, yes, it's a wonderful idea. When you start something, why not think that, yes, this difficult time will also pass. So what I'm trying to say is that, are we really preparing our students, or have we really prepared our students to go through this critical thinking of finding the meaning between the lines? If they are reading even annual reports, can they really find out that? That's what the case is. And today, everybody wants result. Faster result. What? 99% of result in 1% time. Everywhere, you know that. And then, because in the lecture methods, exercise of brain is less. So most of the ones, 99% mechanical use of brain is there. One message came, forwarding. You know that you are teachers. Most of your students will be forwarding messages. Puja will come, Dasara Puja. They will forward the message. Why cannot a student think of some words, some lines which will aptly describe your relationship with the student? But that will happen when you are wishing a student by writing something which is personal. But once you forward the message to your student, or student is forwarding, then here brain exercise is not taking place, and we cannot prepare our students for that. We need to make them exercise their brain. And then group dynamics, the last one here in this slide, you can see that, what is that? You are very hardworking, but see that you ask yourself, or let us ask ourselves, what we are preparing, cook versus chef. If you look at the job of the cook and chef, both of them cook, but cook is underpaid, not respected, not recognized, ignored, but chef is respected, is a star, is available on television shows, reality shows, and also in movies. But what actually we are preparing our students for? I'm not telling you, you prepare them for cook and all. I'm just, it's a just a metaphor that I'm trying to say. Now look at the tailor and fashion designer. That job of tailor and fashion designer is same, but tailor is underpaid, but fashion designer commands in lakhs, some even in crores, and they walk the ramp. So why this difference? The difference between cook and chef and the tailor and fashion designer, or the commonalities between the chef and fashion designer, are what they apply their brain. But cook and tailor, they don't apply their brain to an extent. So what I'm saying is that in a post-pandemic, they want people, they want students, they want employees, those who can apply their brain, not those who will do the manual works, because to do the manual works, we have all the machines. And again, Dr. Sushant, please, in case there is 5 minutes left, please remind me so that I stop things. Before 5 minutes, please remind me. Now, again, aesthetic experience, you see the different colored one. In aesthetic experience, what I'm saying, we need to teach our students to think many ways of interpreting the problem. Let us not give them only one way of interpreting the problem. We have to give them many ways of interpreting the problem. And then we have problem of, say, problem solving schemes and social skills. I'm not getting into that. If there is a question, we'll discuss. All that we understand. So this is what is required in the post-pandemic. These are the skills which are required. Now, so what if taking those skills into consideration, let's see that what actually has been our teaching. Again, I'm saying I'm generalizing. If some of our, some teachers are there who have been wonderful teachers, but see that most of us have been into that absolute kind of thing, the left side, that we focus, we have focused so far in probably content, facts, dates, formulas, theories. But please tell me, is it really necessary to remember the fact? I'm a commerce teacher. I teach financial institutions and markets. Every day I go through what is Sensex and Nifty. I also go through what is a exchange rate because I teach international finance. But is it wise for me to remember what was the exchange rate today? Or is it wise for me to remember what is Sensex or Nifty today? Or is it really wise to make my students remember? Because facts are changing. In that case, what I have to do? In fact, I should prepare my students saying that today, this is the Sensex, this is the Nifty, this is the exchange rate. Please tell me, what will be the Sensex, Nifty or exchange rate after 1 week or after 1 month? If my student is able to predict what will be the Nifty or Sensex after 1 month, then I have done my duty. My job is well done. So today, remembering formulas is not required because those are available in Google, available in systems. You don't need to remember all those, but sometimes we still go for that one. I'm not saying traditional based teaching is wrong. That is the essence, that is the base. But I'm saying the kind of new things should have been adopted, have really adopted those. So what are current trends? We all are doing websites, blogs, Twitter, YouTube. Today, I was very happy to see that it is being live streamed on YouTube, So this is the current trend, which we should do, but how much? We are limited to Facebook and only viewing YouTube, or we are being live streamed in the YouTube and Facebook. The day we are being live streamed in the YouTube and Facebook, that will be our 21st century teaching. And that's what the case is. Then the paradigm shift, again, paradigm shift means what? From before to after, after is excellence. Again, our books, desks, teachers. What I'm saying, I'm sure amongst the audience, there are so many who have written the books. You also know that who are actually being benefited by reading the books. Only teachers are actually benefited by reading the books, because without classroom teaching, most of the books, I'm not saying all the books, without classroom teaching, most of the books cannot be understood by the students. But we are writing the books for the students, but teachers are being benefited. So what I'm trying to say is that let us have a paradigm shift. Let's change post-pandemic change is for excellence, that excellence will come when we write the books which are sort of self-learning materials. We have written the books, even if there is network problem, there is internet problem, there is connectivity problem, even then, if your material is there with the student, student can understand that by going through it. So this is the before and after that you see, but those we can make ourselves visible through virtual classrooms, like we are visible now being thousands miles apart, and through YouTube and other ones which have not kept here, so that we can always do that. So when we are going to do this, I have discussed about the pre-pandemic things and post-pandemic things. So between this pre and post, there are a few challenges, how to overcome those challenges. And before you overcome, there are a few reports. These reports I will not elaborate because the principal and even other GB member and our board of study members, sir, he has also explained very nicely on this. I'm not going to explain on this. Only what I say is that, just see the survey figures. First line, only 23% household has access to internet. If principal is listening, I would have to like to say him, sir, I was very happy to listen to your findings, but I think your findings will be more meaningful if you can divide them into those who have real access to internet and those who do not have one. Number two, those who are from rural area and those who are from urban area, then we meaningful findings from there. But I really appreciate, I really salute you people that during this days, you have made a study, and an NSS report, it's an old one, 17-18, but now reports are there which are not actually conclusive, so I have not shown those, but this was the case. And if you really go through the Transparency International report of the current report, which was released last week, then you find almost there is same one, that minimum maximum households do not have internet, and households with students, only 12% have access to internet. Last line you can see here that most of them have power crisis, power issues, and those are 11%. Now, if you look at the mobile internet in India, you see that, look at the red ones by University of Hyderabad, only 50% of students have laptops. And today I saw that some of our members were using mobiles. It is possible, but is it really possible to have learning through mobiles? Are mobiles the real devices to do that? That is something to be thought of. Then you look at the last but one line here is given, IITians are facing inadequate internet connection and a lack of electronic devices back in their hometowns, because of which attendance rates in online classes are as low as 30%. If this is the case of IITians, just think of what will be the case of others. What the international experience? Please don't feel bad that this problem is only with India. This is the current one, the last 2 days before the report, that this digital divide is not unique to India. But what is different from India to other countries is that during this great lockdown, many countries, those who were very poor and they didn't have a good infrastructure, they went for innovative ideas. But we probably haven't gone for that. Just look at quickly, I think time, Dr. Sushant, again, remind me before 5 minutes that, so you look at Jamaica, Argentina, they have provided the educational website with no financial cost. Rwanda, they have gone for the Google Loon balloons. Once you have Loon balloons, they're up to 65 kilometers, that you'll have free access without any break. They have gone for this. And in Bhutan, they are providing additional data. So developing countries, they are going for educational program, televised educational programs, and all those they are doing. So now, if you come back to that Brainly Global online learning platform, here there are interesting insight that they're saying that here 38% are comfortable joining schools post lockdown. Again, I come back to our principal's reference here, what sir said, that most of them prefer. Sir, many times you have to see, the preference is because they are really curious to see how it is happening online, or they are really interested in that. They are able to really get what they are getting. We have to see that, number one. Number two, you had also mentioned in the slide that in first week to fourth week, in first week there is an attendance of 55 which was reduced to 4, if I have understood this slide properly. Now you see that that itself shows the declining trend, and but we need to find out why such a drastic decline, or what has caused such a drastic decline within the period of 4 weeks, why it has happened. That is the case here. So last time you can see that 53% prefer both a mix of online and offline here, which also corroborates your study. But now, why online? As you have found out, they prefer online ones. What is online here? They are preferring that primarily due to ease of access. Now, being at home, being with a mobile, we can access that. That's good. Safe and social distancing. Now, government is saying maintain social distancing. Chances of catching or chances of contamination is not there because you are not stepping out. That is one. But problem was what? Only 7.7% would want hybrid learning models. Means in the previous slide I had shown you, the last one, you see that they prefer both online and offline education. But here they are saying that only 7.7% want hybrid learning models, and 19% are yet to decide whether they will go to offline or online ones. What I'm trying to say here is, your study is right. This study which I'm showing is also right, but there is no synthesis, there is no alignment. Because why it is happening? Because as some, one of the speakers today in the inaugural function said that this pandemic has caused so much of uncertainty, it is very difficult to predict with certainty what will be the future. How this will affect our psyche, we don't know. Today is, are these are the findings of today. Tomorrow, if same people are interviewed, maybe findings will be different. But question is, if findings are going to be different, how well we as teachers prepared for this, and how well we have prepared our students, or what steps we are taking to prepare our students, that is what is going to make all the difference. So coming to future issues on students, so far what I have discussed what are the pre-pandemic expectations or challenges, what are the signals, then what are the post-pandemic expectations, then on that what research says, then if you are doing that, if you are going for online ones, what are the future issues. This future issue, there are many future issues, but I'm sure some of you have known that is exposure to microwaves. I'm sure those who are using mobiles, if you keep your mobile on, or you are talking over the mobile for 2 hours at a stretch or 3 hours at a stretch, it gets heated. The mobile is getting heated, means there's a maximum flow of microwaves, and that has huge potential to cause damage to our brain. Of course, not in the near future, in the long future it will happen. That means when current citizens reach our stage, say from adolescent they transition to middle age and then old age, then diseases will be more. So what I'm saying, before you get into online mode completely, this is the need of the hour now. I don't say no to that, but we also need to think that is it the only solution, or we have to think of some other model so that we keep our future generation safe and healthy. So what are the diseases in the future that you have to see? Then clarity and brevity, that when you are taking classes online, are you really able to put our ideas across clearly? That is something needs to be thought. Then connectivity push, we cannot do anything much on that. Government has to develop infrastructure. Then collaboration, this is the important point here, that we have all the internet issues and all, we can collaborate. There are many poor students who do not have internet. I think one of the speakers mentioned that one student has committed suicide because couldn't have smartphone. But this online or the collaboration, like if you go to Cashify, they have learned this or launched this. They are saying that India's re-commerce platform. Re-commerce means what? If you have old laptops, old mobiles, old smartphones, you can exchange those, or you can gift those through this platform to the poor students who do not have access to that. That we can do that. So that is the future issue. Then we have to see the crisis with as an opportunity. After this, I have two slides. I'll finish up. What is crisis? Pandemic is definitely a crisis, but I'm very happy that your college has taken this crisis as an opportunity to connect. I'm sure that if it is a normal case, in normal case, college would have organized seminar. So many probably would have not participated, but now because of this one, so many have participated. I really congratulate you. And you see that during crisis of Y2K, 9/11 or global financial crisis, there are a lot of opportunities. What are the opportunities? Y2K led to the business process outsourcing, BPO. 9/11 again led to that. Global financial crisis led to the fintech companies. Today we have Google Pay, or even Zoom classes, or even PhonePe, or all those payment apps that you have, those are in response to the global financial crisis. So what I'm trying to say that this pandemic is also a crisis. We need to convert those crises into an opportunity. So what is the way forward? We need to go for the self-governance. Most of the teachers need to govern self so that we can really adopt those. Then I won't focus on this. You can come straight to the last one, the video streaming, that we actually need to become the YouTubers. We need to have ourselves streamed online so that we'll be able to our students. If we think we are the best teachers, then our knowledge must be accessible to all, but our knowledge will be accessible to all when we are online and seamlessly. That's what I'm saying. So what we do here, I conclude here saying, again, in conclusion, I have three slides. So what online teaching and webinars are norm of the day. We cannot avoid this. But to have this as a norm of the day, we all the teachers need to transform ourselves into a forceful, proactive, and forward-looking warriors to meet the aspirations of India. To anybody saying, or another two slides, I'll finish. So warriors of India, and the temporary response, like we have this webinar, this is a temporary response to the crisis, eventually can lead to a long-term structural impact, that this might become actually a norm for the day. So when we are trying to have this temporary response, how to become actually a long-term structural impact, that we need to have innovation. In this innovation, I'm just having one example of the mask. You can see here, these are the masks. Today, I'm sure that you have heard about this mask more than your name. I repeat, you have heard heard the name of the mask more than your name. Anytime you go out, they say, have you pulled the mask? Have you put on this? But if you are using the mask, do we really understand the product and its uses? We are always calling mask. Why cannot we call it in our local name? You see the names that I have given here. So many names are there. But why mask? What I'm trying to say here is that when you teach our students, we need to innovate. Our teaching has to be so innovative in a manner that they will actually have a blended learning. They will accept this. But here, what is happening? We are simply what you are getting from outside, that you are transferring. So see here, there are three types of masks so far. One is a medical mask, which I had shown here. That speaks of superior hygiene, seriousness. But if you go to the homemade mask, that speaks of practicality, thrift, accessibility, and eco-friendliness. But some people who are emerging and they want fashion ones, that is a desire for self-expression, those masks are different. But instead of saying them, which mask to wear when, we're saying wear a mask. What I'm trying to say here is that we need to teach, we are very committed, but slightly we are going to bring in the blended ones into our teaching so that we'll actually become relevant and we can overcome the challenges of this COVID. So we have taken baby steps out of necessity, but these have to become long-term. This change has to become more permanent. So, or else the last one, you can see that last but one, that if right support system is not there, that the teaching community, then education will take mistakes and eventually will get disillusioned. So with this, I close. Thank you very much. Now it's over to you, Mr. Sushant. Any questions, anything? It's over to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Actually, we will do the questionnaire after completion of the lecture of Dr. Ashish Kumar Sana. Okay.
We'll
move to Dr. Ashish Kumar Sana. But before that, I'd like to comment a very brief comment on the lecture delivered by Dr. Shabat Kumar Didat. Very informative and very, very energetic and a very, very, very novel lecture we have just heard from, and we are very much enriched. As a matter of fact, efficiency means that doing the right thing, and effectiveness does mean that doing the thing rightly, and transformation is that changing the way of doing the same thing. So that's transformation, that kind of transformation we are supposed to bring in our mindset. That is a question of mindset that elaborately explained by Dr. Digal. And as a matter of fact, forecasting is something like driving a car blindfolded while sitting on the back seat and looking through the back window. But that kind of forecasting, Mr. Dr. Digal explained, is not at all useful in terms of preparing a student. We should not prepare the future of the student, but we should build the student for the future. Right, Mr. Digal? So,
yes, thank you.
With this brief comment, I am moving to another distinguished speaker, Dr. Ashish Kumar Sana. Dr. Sana, please deliver your lecture.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am audible?
Yes, you are fully audible.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Respected principal, my senior in my department, Professor Dr. Monidip Chandra, the principal of Kanailal Bhattacharyya, Professor Ostab Lahiri, the governing body president of your college, Brajamohan Mojumdar, your governing body member, Professor Roy, Professor Sushanta Kadar, head of the department of your college, Professor Chinmay Goswami, other teachers of your colleges and other institutions, my good friend and my very, very beloved brother, Dr. Shabat Digal. I know him very long time. And of course, my dear students, I'm really happy that you have invited me in this webinar, that your two colleges have been organized on a very, very relevant topic. The name of the topic is MSME as well as education on and education, especially in the post-lockdown era and its impact. I'm really happy that these two important issues have been identified by your college and very, very pertinent at the right moment. So before, now the time is 1:42. I mean, 1 hour 42 minutes already discussed. So how many minutes I will be getting, sir? How many minutes?
30 minutes. You have 30 minutes. Okay.
Okay. So accordingly, I'll plan. I don't have any. At the right moment, I will not show any PPT. Okay. I'll speak from my.
We have no problem.
Okay.
Carry on.
Okay. So. Thank you. Thank you, Principal Sir, and the other distinguished speakers, that you have rightly pointed out the important key aspects of the two important topics, as well as the impact of the pandemic that we have witnessed since last 2 or 3.5 months. It's really an amazing and a global risk that we are witnessing. And the new term that we are now adopting, which is called new normal. I don't know how many years it will become new normal or it will become normal. So the new normal, when it will become normal, it is very difficult to say. So it depends on time and depends on innovation and depends on the people's consciousness, awareness, so many things. So when it will become normal, we exactly do not know when it become normal. So for every sectors, it is very, very challenging at the right moment, when it will become normal, either the education sector or any kind of sectors. It's really global challenges for the organization, for the human being also. Rightly pointed out our principal said regarding the issues that is very pertinent. Now I come to the point of Dr. Shabat, that he mentioned that the new skills that we need to know. So in my earlier days, I mean, 4 or 5 years back, when I used to teach my NSS students, then we talk about the life skills. What are the different types of life skills that one student, one person, one people should have, so that they will be adaptive at any kind of situation. So this is the one kind of life skills that everyone has to learn, has to adopt, so that whenever any odd situation will face, that they have to adopt. So the life skills, there are some core life skills, there is an additional life skills, there are so many things. So at the right time, this kind of courses also reintroduce in our courses, of course, because the students and the other stakeholders of the society as well as the country, they need to know what are the life skills in a new normal situation, because people are very, very scared about this kind of situation, or very, very in a danger position. Some people are, you know, committed suicide in so many depression cases. So many, we have witnessed so many things for the last 2.5 months, three and a half months. It's really a great challenge. So obviously, the focus today, I'll be sharing my ideas and thoughts, whatever I have gathered for the last few years in terms of the MSME sector. A few questions, of course, to be already been asked by the participants regarding the MSME sector. So you see, if we divide my lecture into two broad categories, one is before lockdown or after lockdown. And that's few important aspects that I want to share before lockdown. So globally, when you talk about the MSME sector, there are some positive, there are some negative aspects of MSME sector. So in India, Shobhat rightly mentioned that 93% are small units. Out of the small units, 93%, almost say 90% of the small units are not registered. Only 3 to 4% of the small units are registered. So medium and smalls, micro units are not registered, sorry. But medium and smalls are registered almost, but micro units, the 93% of the micro units, out of this, only say 80 to 90% are not registered. Almost 10% are registered. So imagine, whatever the data we are gathering, mostly the huge number of MSMEs or micro, they're not came under this kind. So globally, people are directly or indirectly involved in terms of production, in terms of supplying raw material, in terms of the other ways. They are thoroughly associated with this micro and medium and small units. So out of the registered part. So sometimes we are talking about the data, talking about this kind of issues regarding the registered units. But what about the unregistered? This is the first question. So this is a very debatable question, how it can be captured, how it can be improved, because they are not getting proper loan, they are not getting proper support, financial support from the different organizations, as well as the banks, as well as the governments. So this is a really very, very alarming situation at the right moment. Before lockdown, if you look into this, the challenges before the MSME sector, number one, is a global competition. Because you see, the production of these various types of MSME sectors are facing, for the last few years, mostly on the technology-based supported production systems. Because you see, the technologies, the high technologies or high quality technologies are not being adopted by the micro or small enterprises due to their financial problem or the technological support or the other aspects. So another one is the cost effectiveness. I'm just giving two examples in India, especially. Think about the handloom sector. Think about the other micro small sectors where people are directly involved. In our state, in other states, likely in Odisha, like in Bengal, there is a huge number of handloom sectors. They are doing well. But you see, the cost effectiveness is very important. Handloom versus power loom, there is a debate at the right. So when you talk about the handloom as well as the power loom, so the problem is this: the handloom sectors are facing the problems with the cost effectiveness and productivity and so many other things. So that's the challenge, first challenge. Second challenge is I'm just giving one example. Second challenge is if you look into the products that are easily available at a lower cost. Just I have to mention the name. For example, the Chinese products. The Chinese products that are available in India at a lower cost. And it is very difficult to compete with these lower cost products with this Indian MSME sector. It was a really challenge before the lockdown. Third challenge is MSME sectors in India, their marketing are very, very poor. Their channels, marketing channels are very, very poor. Their innovations are not up to the mark. I mean, there are so many other innovation development taking places. And their financial assistance, specially provided by the huge number, by the informal way they are getting finances. So these are the challenges. It's readily available for any textbook or any kind of business works. So these are the pre-lockdown challenges for the MSME sector we are facing that time. So this is one kind of the debate that we know earlier. So if you look into the post-lockdown, think about the post-lockdown MSME sector's challenges and the issues, how they will recover, how the government initiatives, whatever initiatives taken by government, RBI, or the other bodies, other organizations, or the other ways. There are a few questions passed by the participants to the organizers and also to me also. Before discussing the questions, look into this. The important thing is this: when you talk about the lockdown period, MSME sector. Lockdown, especially when it become lockdown, means the MSME sector classified in a different form, in a different types of business. More than 6,000 products they are producing. So many ways they are delivering products and goods. This is the different way they are providing services. Now, what happened? There are a few important aspects. The first one, after lockdown. There are few MSME sectors, they are in operational stage, and there are huge number of sectors, or rather we can say the units, they are not in operational stage because of the different reasons and problems. So what is the problem? Problem is the demand of the product, because the people are not getting to their home to buy the MSME products. This is the one problem. So what is the first one? First one is the demand. If the demand will not come, how the MSME will sell it? How the demand will generate? How the demand will generate? The demand will generate the people when we want to buy. The people do not have the money, the demand will not generate. This is some of the economic logic that we can put. Requesting someone please unmute. Please mute your phone. Otherwise, it's very, very cool. It's going on. Please. So I repeat once again. If there is a demand, there is a demand mismatching. So if you want to produce, then who will buy? Number one. Then how to produce? Because the production units during the lockdown period is not supported by the laborers or the units. Number one. Number two, the employees or the persons, they are not easily came to the office or their factory or their premises, their factory premises for producing the goods and services, whatever. So these are the critical channels that the post-lockdown MSME sectors are facing. And just some of the hints that I'm putting here. Not exactly that, there are so many other aspects. Sorry. These are some of the hints that we put here, the how these MSME sectors have been affected. So taking into the consideration of the next one, if you look into this demand side, there are in India, for example, 130 crore people during the lockdown period. So demand have been drastically gone down. Number one. Number two, at the same time, the people those who want to buy, they do not go out. Number two, the people, those who want to buy, they are not earning. The third point, because they are earning also in a very, very low sphere. So there are different types of products that is not essential, non-essential products are not buying by the people during the lockdown period. Now, the recent reports of the CMI, now it is continuously increasing after the unlock one. So this was the problem in a first case that we have witnessed for the last first three months before unlock. So what happened? Some instances that I have observed that from the unit's point of view, basically the small units, their working capital usually very low. Whenever they go for this kind of bank, the bank will provide some finance or working capital finance or for the cash credit or overdraft facilities, because bank have this kind of facilities. So unless and until the MSME will produce, how the bank will provide this kind of assistance and support to the MSME sector? So that was the problem start. This is called the liquidity crunch started in a banking from the MSME sector. So unless and until the MSME sector will repay the loans or the EMIs or their debts in due time, obviously there is a cascading effect. So due to this cascading effect, so one side is a demand, one side is that they are unable to repay loan, another one side is this that the EMI they are not able to repay. So this is the cascading effects when it percolates. The employees of this organization, at the same time, the organization as a whole, how many months they will pay their salary, the salary to their employees is very difficult. Small units, they have say four or five employees. So unless and until they will make any kind of profit or any kind of sales or turnover, how they will pay to their employees? So it was a very difficult time that they were passing for the past 3 months. So there are so many small organizations, they are facing this kind of problem. And ultimately government took a very, very important decisions that 3 months initially loan moratorium. That means that you do not require to pay at the beginning, you will pay later on. This is the moratorium that you know, loan moratorium. So this is the beginning of the first, stimulus packages given by the RBI for the MSME sectors. This is the first one. The second problem is this: stressed assets. Because you see, once you are in this kind of scenario, that means when you go to the bank is trying to reschedule its NPA, non-performing assets. And its classification. At the same time, banks are providing different types of loans to the MSME sector earlier. For example, different banks have different types of MSME schemes. In one bank, for example, for micro, they are providing, say, Torun, Shishu, or Provin loans. The small, micro, and units. So different schemes they are providing, and they are giving loans to the MSME sector for the different reasons, different purposes, different products, and different services. So due to this, so when they are not getting their EMI, so obviously they are facing this kind of NPA. So what happened from the bank's context? So obviously the RBI is trying to reschedule the NPA. This is one other the problem that they are facing. At the same time, the moratorium, at the same time, these are the situations that happen. Subsequently. The turning or the shift has been taken place. The MSME or the micro small entrepreneurs or the traders or whatever we may be called, they are trying to shift their own original business to the different types of business. They are not concentrating their own business, whatever the business they are running earlier. They have already shifted to the new businesses or the other businesses. Because of that business products and services are not marketable at the particular point of the point in time. So this was happening. So this is the another problem. So the in new normal, when they will come back in their own original business, and actually the people will come, and the regular course of business will starts later on. It is very difficult to say, because you see there are some restrictions of the new normal as well as the guidelines of the ICMR. The footfall of the customers and the other aspects. For example, Shabad also maintained like the hotel industries or the service industries where the footfall is very, very less at the right moment, unless until the footfall increases in the MSME sector, it is very difficult to run the business or to make it profitable. So that's the challenges to survive and to make it profitable. There are important challenges they are facing at the right moment to survive, or it very, very challenging at the right moment to make profit. So forget about the profit. Their first target is to survive in the market. Unless and until they will survive, it is very difficult to make profit in the long run. So in new normal, it is very, very difficult task for the MSME sector whether they will survive in the long run. So these are the challenges in the lockdown period. Now come to this other aspects. So there are some MSME sectors, Shabad also mentioned, and our principal sir also mentioned, and other speakers also mentioned that some SME sectors, basically they are technology driven or service driven, they are getting some benefits due to the lockdown. So whatever we are talking about, any kind of crisis, there are some positive impact, negative impact, or at some, we are talking about the SWOT analysis, there are some weaknesses and threats. Of course, there are some good, there are some bad. So at the same time, some good things, the people are rethinking, people are reorienting their, reorienting their own ideas, own perceptions. Even the micro and small units, so far we interviewed or interacted so many people, they even thought that I'll start a new business, even whatever the business we did for the long time. So it was definitely the one of the important aspect that absolutely is an important thing that they have to shift their own original business to the other business. So this was the challenges that we understood. Now the few questions come to us. So if this is continuing, what will happen? And what are its remedy? Whether the government supports is really sufficient to revive this kind of packages or not? Or sometimes we are talking about the revised definition of the MSME sector is benefited to the MSME sector or not. I'm trying to answer all these questions because you see, I'm just highlighting a few of this, the impact, positive and negative impact. So I mentioned earlier that the RBI also took some initiatives, and government in the package, 2 lakh crore packages, some of the important benefits given to the MSME sector. For example, 50,000 crore equity financing for the given to the SIDBI NABARD for the MSME sector. But the important thing is this: when you are getting the equity, you have to repay the loan. So that is another important one thing, because you see, so when this kind of questions come, then the question is, unless and until you have a good project, good project as well as a good it will not be continuously benefited for the MSME sector. Some people are thinking that once you are getting finance, then the problem will be solved. So far I understand that it is not only the solution at the right moment, that after getting finance, unless and until the demand creates, unless and until the footfall increases, or whatever the way of they are transacting or delivering their goods and services to the mass people or their other people, it is very difficult to survive in the long run. This is another one important point. Second point is this, some stimulus package was there. Second point is this, when you talk about the new definition, that the definition has been changed. Earlier it was only the plant and machinery definitions, only the plant and machinery based on the definitions of the MSME sector. Now it has been revised. So why it has been revised? The important thing is this, we understood that in addition to the investment in plant and machinery, there is another one clause added. The added is this, the turnover also added. Earlier, the turnover was not added. When the turnover added, so when it will become the micro units and when it will become the small units, it depends on the turnover as well as the plant and machinery. Earlier, it was a plant and machinery. For example, I have a plant and machinery, then say more than, say, 25 lakh, then I will become the small industries. But at the right moment, I have a plant and machinery 25 lakhs, but I don't have the turnover at the right moment of say 5 crore, and then I'll not be treated, I'll more than 5 crore or more than, then I'll be treated as MSME sector. So this was the addition, that because you see the turnover decreases, so unless and until the turnover increases, so how they will make profit? That's why the more and more benefits unless and until the benefits that are given. So it is of course that the benefits they will be getting, because you see you have a plant and machinery, but you are unable to sell more and more products to the market. That's why this new addition that we understood. So this is the important aspects of the definitional changes over the time. Whenever the researchers will do this kind of benefits. Or the challenges, so they will, of course, will analyze the impact. So now the question, the another question come: is it possible to revive if the government should support this entire financing or the other supports? Unless and until in the new normal systems, you will reorient yourself. Reorient yourself means, you cannot expect that the 100% footfall or the 100% that you're expecting earlier, it is not possible for the next, at least next 5 years. So how you will reach your existing customers or the new customers, how you will reach? So whether you are able to create this kind of channel or the supply chain management systems or whatever. So unless and until this kind of channel you have to create and maintain, it is very difficult to sustain in the long run. I hope that some of the key issues and impacts that really has a positive as well as a negative impact on the MSME sector at the right moment. And they are facing their challenges. I know there are a lot of questions to be asked by the participants in a different way. Because you see, MSME is a sector where billions of people, or the a huge number of people are working, not only in a production sector, supplying sectors, or the delivering sectors in a different form, right? So this is a question of the right time, the survival question. Whether they will survive in the long run or not in the new normal systems, it is really a very, very difficult challenge. But hopefully, the MSME sector, after getting the finance and the new innovation and techniques, they will be reviving, right? And at the right moment, my suggestion is this: now, unless and until the MSME sectors, their clusters, we know we have a cluster development program. So at the right moment, the MSME should survive if they will form a good clusters. Clusters, the one unit should provide support to the other units, so that they will be getting more and more benefits. This is now the time is in a new normal. Join hand to hand so that you can achieve.
and you can achieve as well as this. You can as well as this. Sorry. You can achieve as this. You can achieve your target as well as this. You will be getting support from other units or from the governments or from the other innovation sectors and government sectors. Hope that I am trying to explain some of the important aspects. This is the vast area. So many issues, so many things need to discuss because the time is very short. That's why I skip so many points. A lot of discussions need to be held on this particular topic in a different aspects, either demand side or a supply side or a collection side or a export side or an import side or a cost effective side or a project management side or an innovation side. Lot of things we need to discuss at the right moment. Innovation and technology, we need to combine so that in the long run, they will survive. Not to make profit at the right moment, they will survive in the long run. Thanks all. Thanks my senior professor, Dr. Chandra. My dad also, I talk about him so many years. We are in a good touch in academics. And my good friend, Dr. Shabat, and Professor Rai, Professor Goswami, Professor Kadar, and so many of my students and my teacher friends, my scholars, I have seen in this webinar that they are making comments. Okay, so hopefully that your college will move forward of this kind of new seminars. And from my department, I really congratulate you for your endeavor and inviting me once again. I am thankful to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Over to Monidip Chandra, sir.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Sana. We are greatly enriched by your lecture. We are greatly enriched by your lecture. And as a matter of fact, this type of webinar will go on continue. This is our planning. We'll continue to have a series of lectures. We are going to move in the questionnaire session. But before going to move in the questionnaire session, I'd like to have a brief observation that, in fact, COVID-19, the novel coronavirus, has changed everything. Everything has been changed totally, and the unique situation, and rightly pointed out that there is no normal situation, there is a new normal situation. Dr. Sana pointed out rightly, a new normal situation, but still, the generic truth that everything is determined by the interaction of supply and demand, that has remained true even during the novel coronavirus. And that is quite visible, quite clear from the lecture of Dr. Sana. Now, we'll move to the questionnaire session. There is a first question I'd like to ask Professor Sana. That is a question put forward by the participants. Which business is going to be affected maximum rate after the COVID-19? Dr. Sana.
Okay, so it's the group. Yes. Are you? Am I audible to everyone?
Yes.
Am
I audible?
Yes.
Okay, good. So this is a good question. It's a very tricky question. It is in one line, it is very difficult to say which business will be affected more. But you see, in a new normal or in a unlock period at the right moment, we can say we are in an unlock period. So in an unlock period, so you see the demand and the criteria. The first one is, the criteria is an essential goods and services. First one. The people are not thinking about the luxurious goods at the right moment. They are thinking about the essential goods and services. So at the right moment. So after a few months, might be the luxurious goods and the other goods they will be purchasing. But at the right moment, the people are thinking about the essential goods and services, which is very, very important to maintain our normal life at the right moment. So those companies and organizations are providing, or small businesses are supplying, manufacturing, or providing services of the essential goods, they will survive at the right moment, that Prabhupada also mentioned rightly. Okay, so at the same time, when you talk about the non-essential goods, which is not essential at the right moment, but the demand not yet created. Once the people will earn, then the demand will create. For example, we know the last CMI data, almost say 25% of the people, they lost their job. So unless and until the people will again get job or earning more and more amount, so the new demand will create. Once the new demand will create, then obviously there is a demand for the new goods and services. So that's why non-essential goods and services, for example, the luxury goods or the other designing goods, so that type of goods and services, they will, in a priority list, in a second, not at the right moment first. So after lockdown and unlock, or the when the new normal will be phased or coming to the normal, then the people will move to the luxurious goods and the other goods, right? So now the another important thing, for example, the transport companies, right? In a public transport to the private transport shifting, that you know. So the another thing is that we have observed. Okay, so affecting mostly the luxurious goods at the right moment, because their demand not yet been created at the right moment, right? So 130 crore people, hardly say 5 to 10% people are go for the luxurious goods. Not 95% people are not been focusing on the luxurious goods. Thank you, sir. Next question.
Will goes to Dr. Sawat Kumar Digal. What will happen to the future of education?
Pardon? What will happen to the future of
education?
thank you for this question. Again, the one who has asked that question has answered. We all of us have known. Education is like MSME, it's a backbone. Education will never stop. This will continue, but in a different form. And what is that form? Like, we had education in a classroom teaching. Now we are having online. But I believe in the future, we will have education. Education delivery. Education means mostly the delivery form. I think delivery will be much better, because we had not faced this kind of problem before. Now that we have faced, so when we design our course material, when we design our delivery mechanisms, we'll design in such a manner that in future, God forbid that shouldn't happen, but in future, if this kind of pandemic happen also, education will not be interrupted. But I see a bright future for education. There is, it's wrong to say bright future, but I find education thriving on it, but in a different form. Right. Thank you.
Sir, there is another question for you, Dr. Digal. That is, up to what level we can encourage online education?
This all depends on, whosoever has asked this question, again, I thank the person for having asked, because this question had some thought in the mind, so it's good. That's what I was saying. We are only teaching our students, or we are encouraging them to think. The person has thought about it, it's good. So extent depends upon what you are teaching, what subject you teach, and what kind of infrastructure you have in your institution. That will depend. But if you ask me, I would say that we will keep minimum of this online and maximum of the offline, because in classroom teaching, we have maximum things, and the cognitive development comes in the classroom. I repeat, cognitive development comes in the classroom. So if you have more of classroom and less of online, it's always better. But as of now, if you ask me, probably I'll say that, say in another 1 or 2 years, we'll have 90% or 80% classroom and 20% offline. But it all depends upon what kind of subjects you teach and what infrastructure you have. But thank you very much for this question.
Thank you, sir. Now, another question is, Professor Dr. Sana, is only financial assistance sufficient to revive the MSMEs?
I already answered the question, because the financial assistance is not only the way to revive the MSME sector. Because you see, I know you are giving my finance at the right moment. Right. So how I utilize my finance is very important one. Unless and until the product will create, demand will create. Number two, unless and until the business will reorient. Only the 30% of the only 30% of your existing customers, for example, at the right moment, in a new normal, they are usually to attend your organization to buy your to buy your goods and services. So what about your another 70%? So you have established and cost so many fixed costs, right? So financial, at the same time, finance is important, but at the same time, you have to reorient yourself, rethinking yourself, how to deliver the goods and services to your customers in a new normal situation, so that you can reach so many people, reach your existing customers, at least at the right moment. Because you see, the Shabbat is rightly mentioned, and I also agreed with him, because you see, at the right moment, we don't have any kind of this kind of databases of your customers in a small business. Big companies, they have a databases of the existing customers. But small businesses, you don't have any databases. Who are your existing customers? So unless and until you know your existing customers, at least the 30%, or rather the prospective customers, how do you make profit? Number one point. Number two, a lot of new things and products that you have to innovate at the right moment. Innovation is very important. Okay, so this is not the only criteria. I repeat once again, at the same time, innovation at another point I already mentioned that at now we are in an age that we have to join hands to survive all of the people in a similar way. So that we have to create the clusters, create the big forum. So everybody should join the forum, and as well as they will motivate each and everyone. Thank you, sir. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Sana. It's quite obvious. Now I am over to Dr. Sushanto Karar for next series of questions, two or three questions. Okay.
Already we have received a large number of questions, mainly arising from the MSME sector. Although mostly they are in common nature, I am trying to satisfy few of them. My first question to the Dr. Ashish Kumar Sana is, how SSI can face this crisis is mentioned by many participants. How SSI can face this crisis?
I have already mentioned from the different aspects that I've already mentioned how SSI or small units. So I mentioned that 93% of the micro units in India, almost out of the 93% of the micro units, there are a huge number of micro units. There are informal micro units, not registered micro units, right? So the databases or their problem is quite critical at the right moment, because you see, their original business, they have to shift the new businesses, right? So they are facing a lot of problem at the right moment due to finance, number one, due to demand, due to supply, and due to the payment of their the own employees, right? Or to even not to maintain the fixed cost, or even they don't have this kind of amount that they are required to repay these, for example, to EMI to the different NBFC companies or the microfinance companies. So that's why they are facing a lot of problems at the right moment, because most of the micro units, they are taking loan from the NBFC or microfinance institutions, or even the money lenders from the different places, right? So they are facing a critical juncture at the right moment. How to survive? Okay.
Okay, sir. Now, one of the another question also to Dr. Ashish Kumar Sana. At presently, the government of India have declared a financial package for the MSME sector. What is thinking about this package, whether it be sufficient or not to the MSME sector?
No. I already mentioned I already mentioned it.
Yes, I already have mentioned that very good. Money is not sufficient,
but
yes, demand is
any kind of assistance is good.
Already answered.
Okay, sir. Go. I am. Please, Dr. Kinwai Kanji Goswami,
please ask if you have any question.
Many questions actually thrown by so many participants, but I actually selected two or three questions which are relevant for the discussion. What is the impact on education? First question, my first question is to Dr. Dhival. What is the education process for post-COVID-19? What is the education process for post-COVID-19? Dr. Dhival.
Thank you, sir. Education process for post-COVID-19 will be what? First thing is infrastructure, which is not in our hand, that is with the government. And please remember, when you talk about infrastructure needs investment, and we, as all common people, understand it is a capital investment which will take long time. Number two, in the short run, what we can do is that, or what thing I expect is that, we need to develop materials which are known as self-learning materials, so that whenever this kind of crisis take place, that those materials can be distributed to the students and they can learn with minimum intervention of the teachers. Number two. Number three is what? That we teachers will also have some live streaming or our recorded videos, which will be available in YouTube and other channels, and that will actually supplement. So I'm just saying three things. One is, first one is investment in infrastructure, which is time. Second one is live streaming, and preparing of self-learning materials, and third one is live streaming. So these three things will dominate our future of education. Thank you.
My next question I am presenting to Professor Dr. Ashish Kumar Sana. Please highlight some actions that may be taken by the center and state government. What would be the alternative way of teaching learning process for the students who belong to socially and financially backward families? Dr. Sana. Dr. Sana, you can hear my question.
Chinmay Babu,
hello.
Do you have any question for Dr. Dhival? Do you have any question for Dr. Dhival?
Next question. I am presenting next question to.
I think this is supposed to be the last question. Okay.
This is the last question. This is the last question I am presenting to Professor Dr. Dhival. Does higher education affect the student's career? If same situation continues till year end, what will be the situation of teachers? How will government and private institution protect the readers? Professor Dr.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. I thank you and also the person who has asked this question, because this question is very close to my heart. So if you say the first part of your question, that how this higher education is affecting, higher education affects, because higher education is a platform from where you directly jump into your job market, or you want to become entrepreneur, or you want to get into politics or wherever. So this actually affects, number one. Number two is what? There are a lot of studies on education. If you look at the in the Ebola case, which happened in West Africa some years back, because of Ebola disease, for 1 year, all the education institutions were closed. And when all those education institutions were closed, what happened? Today we find, after so many years, all the children or the students who are not going to the school or colleges, they have actually not become normal citizens. Normal citizen is what? Most of them have become juveniles, or even exploitation of girls had increased. And even the cognitive development, which a student gets being in the class, that was found less in those students who have missed the classes or missed the school during Ebola time. So if you take that as a base, if you take that as a background, then I definitely say that if students are missing at the school or higher education for a long time, that is going to affect the society. That is one of the reasons why I was saying that we teachers have the role to see that despite having a lot of problems on online or in internet or in network or in signals, we need to devise the methods of teaching in such a manner that we are constantly in touch with our students, either directly in the classroom or indirectly through YouTube or recorded video. The students feel our presence in them, and then they remain a good citizen. So this is the impact, that's a huge impact. Unfortunately, we don't have good findings on this because research on this area is not done much. Like in other areas, we have done research and next month or next day findings come out. Here, research hasn't been done, but whatever few researchers we have, both in developed countries and the one I have mentioned, there it happens. And one also in Europe, those students were engaged in strikes and not attending classes. They were not displaying the cognitive development. So if this can happen in Europe, can happen in West Africa because of Ebola, this can happen in our country and elsewhere in the world. So I sincerely wish that there is an interaction of students with the teachers and that interaction mostly with the classrooms. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Digal. Thank you, Dr. Sana, for taking all the troubles of answering patiently of all the questions. Now I request Dr. Sukanto Kanar to deliver the vote of thanks, formal vote of thanks. Dr. Kanar.
Good evening to the Honorable President, respected principal, respected speaker, delegates, and participants. First of all, I would like to offer my heartiest thanks to Principal Sir. You gave me an opportunity to speak on this auspicious occasion, and it is a matter of honor for me. Our Principal Sir is the main supporting head of this webinar. Within a few minutes, have been permission for such webinar. Technical, non-technical, all parts are properly managed by him. Thank you very much, sir. At the same time, I would like to offer my sincere thanks to Dr. Kostab Lahiri, principal of Dr. Kanailal Bhattacharyya College, Howrah. I would like to offer my sincere thanks to Bhojomohan Mujumdar, president of our college, and a very special thanks to Professor Kritish Kumar Roy, governor GB member of our college, and thanks to all other GB members. Secondly, my thanks to Dr. Ashish Kumar Sana, head and professor, Department of Commerce, University of Calcutta. Sir, MSME helped us to organize this webinar, not only as a speaker, but also extend his helping hand towards every aspect of the webinar. I would like to offer special thanks to Dr. Ashish Kumar Sana. I would like to offer my sincere thanks to Dr. Sobhat Kumar Dikal, Associate Professor, Department of Commerce, Dinobundhoo University, Bhubaneswar, Odisha, who accept my request without any hesitation within a few minutes, instead of visit his role. It is a great pleasure to express my deep sense of gratitude to my old respected teacher associate with Department of Commerce, Shibpur Institution College. Thanks to all my departmental faculty members. Last but not least, the webinar delegates, participants who are the main pillar of the webinar. In today's webinar, delegates are representing more than 400 colleges and 26 different universities across the country. I would like to offer my sincere thanks to all delegates, participants for supporting us, for showing interest about the webinar, for wholehearted participation and patience of presenting. Again, a thanks to all of you. Now, Principal Sir, please.
Thank you. Thank you, all of you. Now I declare the conclusion of this national level webinar. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.